everybody. I'm talking about the state of ARM and POWER PC, or as it's generally marketing known as these days, POWER on Fedora. They're the two main architectures or groups of architectures, really, that as my role in release engineering, I'm responsible for. I also get to do bits on S390 and the MIPS guys, who I'm not sure whether they're here.
Yeah.
Excellent. I'll speak to you later. But yeah, so the vast majority of my time, of my day job day-to-day, is spent on ARM and POWER. So that's primarily what I'm going to cover today, because that's what my head is primarily filled with. So I'm going to start with core toolchain and toolchain features and functionality. In all of these cases, in the case of both ARM and POWER, across ARM covers ARMv7, i.e. the 32-bit ARM that we support, plus ARC64 or ARMv8 architecture, and the POWER side of things supports PowerPC 64-bit in both little and big endian modes. So that is primarily what I'll be covering off. In terms of the core toolchain, so GCC, glibc, binutils, and friends, we're primarily feature complete and identical in terms of core functionality with x86-64. There's a few bits and pieces here and there that are a little bit behind. PowerPC, for example, doesn't have full setconf support as yet, although it's being worked on and should hopefully land shortly. But generally speaking, on a day-to-day functional level, there's very little difference between all the architectures. And as a core toolchain used to build the distro should be, it's relatively boring. But then you start to get into more of the fun, interesting toolchains that, while aren't used to build the core distribution, are starting to become dependencies for core functionality such as Docker, containers, various other bits and pieces that, while we don't strictly need them, there's a lot of interest in them and a lot of use cases for them. Golang runs on ARMv7, runs just fine. On ARM64 and PowerPC64, the support has mostly landed upstream with the Golang 1.5 release. So we're starting to deal with bootstraps and various other issues. So hopefully by the time F23 goes GA, we should have most of that stuff in place. Of course, there's also GCC Go, which works actually fairly well and is mostly feature complete, or has feature parity with Golang. Although we're still sort of, there's still work how to deal with different tool chains to achieve the same goal in Fedora in general. So the support there is still a bit more up in the air. Feel free to interrupt and ask questions if anyone has any specifics on the way through. Getting to the various different editions that we now have in primary, I'll cover over server, cloud, and workstation. The server edition is basically the same. There's a few minor functional differences in the way things are being produced at the moment. We're working to ensure parity across all of that. On the POWER side of things, it's 100% there, as you would expect. ARC64, it's pretty much 100% there. it's relatively boring, very stable, and generally just works. And we're enabling more and more features and functionality along the lines of Docker and containers and rollkit and testing and integrating. But for all intents and purposes, the vast majority of the server edition across all the ARM and Power architectures is complete in there. Cloud Edition, on the Power side of things, we released the first cloud images as part of Fedora 22. We didn't quite make it there with some bits of functional issues with some of the tools we used to build that on AR64, with some issues surrounding console support, EFI bootloader support. I'll get to more of that later, and a few other bits and pieces around there. But we're getting there, and hopefully in the F23 cycle, we should start to see cloud images or QEMU-based images for AR64. There'll be Docker images for both Power and AR64 for F23. And then we'll start to build up some of the functionality similar to what Primary is getting in terms of layered images and stuff like that.
For the ARM stuff, where would you deploy that?
In what? Deploy what exactly?
The cloud images.
ARM supports hardware virtualization, so there are people that are using.
You can run OpenStack, like the OpenStack nodes on AR64. You private cloud.
There's not a lot of public clouds yet that support AR64 as an architecture. We don't.
No.
That will change in the future, but we'll be ready for it when they run it.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of images are sold as cloud images, but like the base Fedora cloud images are QEMU images. You can run them anywhere you have KVM hardware there. And so, you know, the Fedora cloud QEMU base images, for example, on x86, you can run on your laptop, or you can run in OpenStack, or you can run in Over or Rev, or anywhere else that supports KVM Ver. So just because they're labeled cloud, they're not just Amazon, or they're not just OpenStack, because I mean, ultimately, depending on the edition of OpenStack you're running, obviously, OpenStack, any OpenStack instance that's running KVM hypervisors, you can run, you know, x86, the Fedora cloud images. But you can also run them on your laptop. So it's, you know, you can have your own private little, so anyone that has ARM64 hardware has hardware vert capabilities there. Anyone that has in-house or local Power hardware, or like Power 8 hardware, which supports libvert, KVM, and everything else, can run the Power cloud images. So yeah, just because it's cloud, it's like, for example, we're not producing EC2 cloud images on either Power or AR64 because EC2 doesn't support it. So it makes no sense to do that. But in the case of, say, ARMv7 Docker images, which Dennis produced for F22, there are hosting providers out there now that are doing cheap ARMv7 hardware, and you can run the Docker images on those. So there is some public ARMv7. I'm not sure of any publicly announced ARMv8 or Power public cloud instances, but you know, there's a lot of companies that are using it for other things internally on private clouds or just standard virtualization. Workstation Edition. I'm told on Power it actually works. I'm not aware of anyone that is actually using it in production, because there's not really currently any Power-based workstation-style things where you would use it on a day-to-day It does work, it's all built, not widely tested. Similarly with AR64, it works. There's a few people around that have managed to find ancient graphics cards that will run on the PCIe buses, and it works fine. In the coming year or so, and Mr. Masters wandered in and then wandered straight back out again. But there's going to be a lot more lower-end style dev boards and things like that coming out where workstation will make more sense. So it all works, it's there. We're not actually producing workstation images just simply because at the moment there's no real demand for it because there's not really the publicly accessible hardware to do so. And the few people on the power side that have shown interest in running the desktop edition on power have done it with custom installs anyway. So it's there, it works, it's improving. There may be, I hope in the case of AR64 in the next year, some decent, cheap, readily available desktop, laptop style hardware, which will make it worthwhile starting to produce said images.
That's what you said last year.
Of course. Well, it's probably what I'll say next year as well. Right. And it's being recorded, so you can quote it back at me.
Okay.
Which is why I said hopefully.
Yeah. Seems like we had some kind of a bet on when that first hardware was going to be available for $100. We all lost that bet.
I never was involved in that bet because I was always skeptical. there are, like with the Hi-Key board, or the 96 boards, the consumer edition, in particular the Qualcomm board, the upstream developer that's been developing that open source has AR64 running, like Fedora ARM64 running on it, running full known shell, and fully accelerated and everything. So it can be done, and there is, like that, the Qualcomm stuff is available. The bootloader is truly terrible, but that's no different to any of the other Qualcomm dev boards that have been out. Hopefully, that was the 96 board Enterprise Edition with the AMD Seattle in it has been announced. Should hopefully be out before the end of the year. I was told, I think, October?
Real soon.
Yeah. So,
year of the Linux desktop.
Yeah.
Year of the Linux ARM desktop.
64-bit ARM.
64-bit ARM desktop.
And from the ARM v7 point of view, the NVIDIA Tegra stuff is now almost upstream completely. The user space is all there. The firmware, surprisingly, is actually upstream. And the final bits of the kernel are scheduled for 4.3. And so that will give us, finally, yay! And Ian, I did say that last year and the year before on the ARM v7 stuff, will actually give us a nice, fully accelerated 32-bit solution. So I was thinking about bringing the board with me and trying to do the presentation on it, but given that I actually did most of this presentation after I arrived, I didn't think it was necessarily the best thing to do. The rest of the general user space, well, there's 18,000 odd source packages in Fedora in general. The vast majority of the user space is there. There's a number of corner cases on ARM64 and Power. ARM64 doesn't have mono, with the rebase to mono 4. All of Power has mono now. But we're in a pretty good shape. Like, as people are starting to use Fedora on both ARM and POWER more. We're seeing more and more sort of optimization bugs, a few runtime bugs, a few assumptions made by, you know, different projects about bits and pieces, but I think that's really good because it shows people are actually using things and testing use cases and generally trying to do day-to-day work with it and are finding these bugs and reporting, which is good because it's really relatively straightforward to compile those 18,000 source packages onto different architectures and go, yay, we have all but 250 packages built. But it's not until people start to use them that you start to see bugs about the usability of them. And if you're starting to get bugs, it means people are using it, which is awesome. Kernel, on the power side of things, very boring. There's some interesting features that have been coming along there with regards to some of the advanced power hardware. Most of the best way to find out about those features and functionality is openpower.org website. There's a few issues there we've seen with feature enablement in 4.2, which meant we had to disable a few things like transactional memory and bits and pieces like that. By the time F23 comes out, they should be enabled and back and there. On the ARM64 side of stuff, with the 4.0 kernel that F22 shipped with, we have enough upstream that we managed to drop the big ARM64 kernel patch, which at one point was around 100,000 lines of code that we were patching into the Fedora kernel. Now the only patch for ARM that we carry is for an out-of-tree pre-production hardware NIC that will never go upstream because that hardware revision will never be generally available. So we carry it at the moment to make it easier for people with that hardware to test and consume. But that is literally, at the moment, the only patch we contain. With the 4.1 kernel, we landed the massive big ACPI patch. It's not enabled by default because on the Mustang board in particular, it will take you back to a feature set about the equivalent of 3.17 with device tree, where you get a single NIC and a SATA port and a serial console, and that's about it. But that's quickly evolving. There's a huge raft of ACPI-based enablement, hardware enablement patches that are on their way into 4.3. And so I think with 4.3, maybe 4.4 ACPI should be functionally equivalent to device tree. But that's been relatively amazing. And the ability to be able to use a pure upstream kernel has made my life and a bunch of other kernel people's lives much easier and much less stressful when patches don't rebase and we have to run around and get that fixed because it, you know, generally will interrupt, you know, x86 and the things that other people need to do to develop the distro. So, I mean, that to me was a big step in the evolution of AR64 in Fedora, or in my opinion, general as a platform, to show that it is coming of age, so to speak, in that we don't need to carry a whole bunch of non-upstream packages. Bootloaders, I mentioned before that I would touch on this again. Obviously in the ARM64 space, we're purely, at least at the moment, UEFI based. One of the issues with regards to this and cloud images is that we don't actually have the ability to redistribute a completely open UEFI bootloader. Hopefully soon, John, I see you're raising up the back, but do you have a comment to make
on
the state of that?
Sorry, I was in a meeting during lunch.
That's all right.
So the issue, as I understand it, without going to a giant tangent, is you can build and distribute EFI the TIAMI, but it's just down to the problem of the licensing, right? So
it's the VFAT driver licensing in particular, which makes it currently unpalatable to Fedora.
Watch this space, I think. It's being worked on, and there is, watch this space.
I've heard that for 2 years.
I've recently acquired a bigger stick through somebody else I can leverage. Watch this space.
Yeah, so from an AR64 point of view and virtualization, when that happens, it'll make the bootloader and cloud side of things much easier for us to deal with.
Here's a question. I mean, we'll talk about this a little time, but for Fedora, the sort of reviving the conversation, treating this.
Can we take this?
Yeah, let's take it.
So that's AR64. On power, power users, I forget what the acronym stands for, but it's OBL, which is an. Anyway, it's completely open, standardized bootloader, very similar to the, and that's used both in the virtualization use case and on the, as part of the Open Power Consortium. The Open Power hardware also uses that same bootloader. That's all packaged up and ships and just works with Fedora Vert, which is great. ARMv7, obviously we have U-boot. That's evolving actually quite nicely, and we have 130 odd boards the last time I looked that we should be able to boot using a standard distro boot procedure using ext linux conf to give us standard upgrade paths, single kernel and all of that sort of stuff. So it's still evolving, it's still being polished. We have a few minor issues there around setting of consoles and stuff like that. But generally, on the vast majority of the platforms, the actual devices that we currently support, all of that is there. Most of it's upstream. I think we carry 4 or 5 patches in total for that we're working with the upstream maintainers to polish up and get upstream. But again, it's obviously not quite as neat as we would like, but a number of the vendors have picked that up now and are using the upstream distro. So any of the NVIDIA stuff, you can literally just plug in a Fedora card and it will just boot, which is kind of nifty. And it's taken us a long time to get to that. From the F13 sort of release with Seneca, F14, where we had multiple kernels and cobbled together U-boots from God knows where. Similarly, the Anaconda installer, a number of people have asked me, when will ARMv7 support, Anaconda install? Well, it does, and it has done for some time. You can pixie boot. ARM doesn't tend to have the traditional x86 put in a DVD style install, but you can pixie boot from U-boot and do a complete interactive Anaconda install exactly as you would, or you can use a kickstart install exactly as you would on x86. And the same is the case on ARM 64-bit, and the same on all of the power platform. So while the lack of optical media and bits and pieces like that are somewhat different ways of consuming Anaconda than people are traditionally known to use on x86, the mechanism is generally the same and works.
Yes. So correct me if I'm wrong, but on 32-bit ARM, although you can run through an interactive install, generally speaking, it won't boot when it's done. You'll end up with a working
image. It depends on the system that you have.
Yep. Does Anaconda actually have code to detect or to ask you which SPC you're on and then do the... I don't want to derail your...
There's
It will detect, yes, based
so like,
on the
like
device.
If you install into a system that, at least at the moment, if your system, the partition that you're installing to is not the partition, that you, not what you boot from. So if your U-boot is on flash, or if your U-boot is on an SD card and you're installing onto a SATA disk, you do the install, and at the end of it, you reboot, it's going to reboot.
Okay.
If the you have to like put U-boot into the start of an SD card, and you install to that SD card today, Anaconda wipes that, and we don't have something that is putting U-boot back in place. And so in that case, it doesn't reboot. You've then got to go take the card out, put it into flash in a U-boot, and then
okay, that makes sense. So if you've already set up U-boot to work, and that's how you bootstrap Anaconda, then it will work.
Yeah, and there's a number of people that actually put in a like a scriptlet
mm-hmm.
in the post install of a Kickstart to do that for them. At which case it's automated, and you don't need to faff about with other machines. If the U-boot is on like a NAND ROM or something like that, all the detection is there, and it will just boot.
Maybe worth noting on AR64, people have done a DVD. It's not a common case. You can do a DVD or a USB install.
Yes.
Nice.
Yeah, on AR64 with the UEFI of the platforms we've currently tested and support, which is Mustang and Seattle, but there are other. I know people have been testing it on Cavium hardware. I'm not lucky enough to have a 48-core piece of Cavium hardware to play with and test it on. But with the standard UEFI, where the UEFI on those more expensive boards is on a NAND ROM, it will work with traditional, legacy, whatever you want to call it, spinning media. And questions?
How are we going to go about uniting the various Kojis into one Koji so that they're using Koji Shadow all the time? What needs to happen there?
That's sort of not entirely related to my support of ARM and POWER hardware. It's something that I have been, it's something that I would like to do. To give a brief overview of it, the idea is to decouple the concept of primary and secondary architectures from where they reside in what Koji instance. So, in the case of like 32-bit Intel or 32-bit x86, they're wanting to demote like the cloud image and the server image to a secondary architecture, but as it currently sits with regards to that, how do you then take that 32-bit architecture and then say leave all the spins in place as primary on 32-bit and then put the server and cloud into a different Koji instance? Well, you don't. So the idea is basically we will decouple the Koji from the secondary and primary, and then potentially import all the architectures into a single the single primary instance of Koji. And so when you build something, it spits out all the architectures in a single build. At which point, the way you compose as a primary or a secondary can be done as a separate feature, or it can all be done as a single process of composing the distro, say, for the server image, and then where you then put it on the mirrors determines whether it's primary and secondary, or the QA process that it goes through. This is a primary architecture for the server edition, so we're going to QA it in this way. For all these secondary architectures of the server edition, we're going to assume that it's basically working in the same way as it is on primary, so we're going to do less QA on that. So there's a bunch of ideas floating around. There's no roadmap as to how that will happen, if it will happen, and what the final outcome will be. But that's some of the ideas that are sort of starting to be discussed and float around.
On a related note, if you do
do one unified Koji instance, would you fail to build in a secondary Arch?
No.
Yes.
Sorry. Yeah, no, it runs like, if the build fails on A architecture, it fails on all. But the fact of the matter is, and dealing closely with secondary Arches every day, in most cases, it's rarely an architecture problem that fails a build. There are a few, the big one that comes up on a slightly more regular basis than most is a big Endian issue versus a little Endian issue. But in the case of like the core Fedora that is used by everyone every day, if a GCC build fails due to an issue on one of those architectures, the GCC maintainer is going to have to fix it anyway. And when the GCC maintainer pushes GCC builds, he simultaneously pushes GCC to all of the Koji instances at the same time. If a build fails on power on GCC, he re-spins that and pushes it to all the architectures anyway. So a lot of people are dealing with that sort of stuff already. And in the case of dealing with, say, some graphical package, say Blender, for example, I happen to know it builds on all the architectures, but say, for example, Blender goes, we don't support power, or we don't support S390. Well, that's already the case, and the architecture maintainers have already put in exclude Arch S390, exclude Arch this, exclude Arch that. So, for all intents and purposes, a lot of the process we do already deals with that. And there's probably four or five people in Red Hat that are dealing with Koji Shadow, dealing with failures from Koji Shadow and stuff like that. And it suddenly frees them up from a very tedious, very repetitive, and the most problematic part of building the secondary architectures is actually not the building of the packages, but issues with the tooling and various other bits around the packages, which if a single package fails and causes other things to block, it ends up costing the maintainer of that package, in most cases, more time than it would be if when it fails, if it failed across all six architectures at the same time, it would probably take the maintainer less time to fix it then and there to get it to build on all architectures than the loops required often to go around and back, around and back, around and back between the architecture maintainers and the package maintainers to get that fixed, which gives like the package maintainers instant failure, so they know that it's an issue then and there. And if it's because some feature has been enabled, like landed, like a new major version with a feature that uses, say, Mongo, which we don't currently support on AR64, they can go, if ArchSys, disable that feature then and there and deal with it. And maybe file a bug, file a bug with the architecture guys so that they can do it. And it gives the guys that are doing this repetitive task day to day a whole bunch, like frees up probably the vast majority of their time. And I can pretty much, from working on secondary Arches now for 5 years, the time that's freed up, only a small time of that would then need to be spent assisting other people with those sort of failures to get them fixed quickly so that it doesn't block that functionality. Does that answer your question?
John?
Yep.
And then you think about it some more, you think, well, actually, coming back to the old Riggs proposal and the minimal OS footprint that Denise was talking about and so on, actually it all kind of fits in nicely, because if we build a very minimal core base, not core OS, base OS, whatever you want to call the lowest piece, actually this fits in very nicely, because that's going to be basically a quote-unquote primary on everything.
Yes. Yeah. And you know, it links in well to Denise's talk of what Red Hat needs from Fedora, because Red Hat already supports, you know, Power Big Endian, Power Little Endian, S390, AR64, and that core group, in most cases, either has a Red Hat maintainer or a co-maintainer, or Red Hat actively participating in the maintenance of those packages anyway. And so part of their day job is to ensure that it builds across all the architectures that Red Hat cares about. So it's part of their day job anyway. And it's something they do, and I know there's a number of packages, not going to mention anything like Java, but I have a constant backwards and forwards with the Java maintainers about the architecture stuff, and it's not their fault at all, but you know, they'll push a build, it will break something in AR64, I go and say, hey guys, this is broken, and then we go backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards. It ends up being, if they know that they need to deal with all of that at the same time, it ends up like probably saving, in the last case we did this, probably half a day of their time and a whole bunch of my time.
And Peter, perversely, those guys are actually doing a lot of AR64 builds anyway, so it's even on different, on their own local machines, so it's even worse because they're doing it at the same time.
I mean, one of the interesting side effects from that, they're like, oh, OpenJDK upstream builds fine on AR64. And it's like, what kernel are you using?
Yeah.
3.19. Well, this one's broken in 4.0, even though the actual ABI or anything didn't change because of the big number jump. Minor things broke. Yes, Adam?
So, since it's not a primary architecture, if it's something that is purely community maintained and purely community based and is not somebody actually working on this as their day job, if it breaks on secondary and just like making a conditional inspect file to just say ignore the architecture, is that acceptable by the secondary architecture?
Yes, that happens already now.
No, I know it happens already now. You're talking about like this proposal where we all build together.
You should be filing a bug.
Yes.
Somebody and block the arch tracker so that someone from the arch team can know about it.
Yes, you should. I agree. I'm getting to the point where somebody does this in their free time. It fails on AR64. AR64 is the primary. They say, I care zero, and just comment out and move on. Like, at what point does that become a point of contention?
I think it's
going to
end.
The thing is, that already happens now, and it is already at times a bone of contention as it is.
Okay.
So, in terms of increasing or decreasing that bone of contention, I don't think it will change the status at all.
Okay. So the goal is just to increase visibility into the problem. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and it also, it enables like a lot of like I have. People like multiple times a week saying to me, why isn't AR64 server edition primary? And it's like, well, because. And like, because why? It's like, because in the current state of promoting an architecture, we have to do server, we have to do, well, if you go
it's
back, it's an all or nothing thing. And at the moment, it makes no sense to promote, say, cloud on AR64 to a primary architecture, or even like, say, on like cloud on power, cloud on power and a primary architecture, and make it blocking because there's not a lot of people using it. And so, you know, it's the sort of thing that would be remain perfectly in secondary, but you know, server on AR64 is something I'm asked about multiple times a week. So the ability to say, right, server on AR64 is ready for primary, let's promote it, and all it is flipping of some bits rather than a huge, massive amount of work and everything else. It's similar to like the demotion of I686 on server, which has been discussed on the mailing list. At the moment, it's just like, you know, we're not producing the bits anymore. Where if we have the ability to say demote that, and then there's this massive outroar in the community that use it on a day-to-day basis that don't follow the list closely and probably actually don't test something until it goes GA, we can go, oops, sorry, we fucked that up, and quickly re-promote it in the next cycle or something like that without major amounts of work required by a small amount of people, as is the currently the case to demote or promote an architecture.
Right, that's only possible because ISO 86 is on the primary code you build.
Yeah. Yeah, so at the moment we're demote, I mean, in the case of ISO 86, we're sort of already implementing this policy because with the demotion of some subsets of ISO 86 to secondary, they're not getting holus bolus evicted from Koji and expected to go and set up another whole set of Koji instances and build a whole bunch of community around that and everything.
They're not getting demoted, like the cloud image just went away.
Yeah.
And you know, we don't have a way at the moment to promote or demote stuff. We need tooling work to be able to do that. But in theory, we can much easily do that.
Yeah.
And by having everything built in once, there's times where it's going to cause a little pain for people, but most of the time they're never going to notice it, and you know, the stuff's just going to build, and we just carve up the output and ship it into different locations. And
I mean, we've had a few, like in the lead up to F21 going. Like in the dev cycle, I think it was just before beta, there was a toolchain issue discovered on S390, but that's still necessary. A partial mass rebuild across all of primary anyway. So there are issues there that, like, people say, oh, you know, if something happens on S390, it doesn't affect primary. Well, actually, yes, it does. You as the random person who said that doesn't care anything about S390, didn't see me doing an entire weekend of work to do a partial mass rebuild to on primary to get that fixed. Similarly, I forget exactly the component, but in the lead up to F22, there was a issue in part of the tool chain that actually that package, I think it was bin utils, it might have been elf utils, it was one of those low level tool chain bits. And it regressed. The regression on that affected actually all architectures, but it instantiated itself slightly different on AR64 and actually stopped that from building altogether for whatever reason. But when the maintainer went and actively looked at it, he went, oh shit, this is like a toolchain bug issue across all architectures, and we have no idea why we didn't see it on x86. So there is value there. So
That's come up a couple of times with GCC as well, where there's been a bug that has manifested itself on PPC or S390, but the bug is it's in the generic code parts and exists on x86 and all the other arches, but for some reason it isn't visible, you know, it's getting hidden, and it is a bug that maybe not tomorrow will cause issues, but you know, down the road will cause issues. Having that wider build, you know, coverage does help.
I think having a wider ecosystem of architectures is healthy for the project as a whole and benefits each other.
Not only is it healthy, I think we've shown a pretty good track record of taking care of these sorts of issues when they pop up.
Yeah.
So eat your vegetables is the
fruit.
Short answer to this.
I mean, and after F22 came out, there was a person in the community that had been massively critical of ARM being promoted to ARM v7 being promoted to primary. He'd been massively critical, massively vocal, and when I sent out the release announcements for AR64 and POWER, he actually emailed me personally and said, well, I want to say thank you. The uplift I've seen in the secondary architectures is actually making a really positive effect. And like, it was just as well I was sitting down when I got this email, because like I had to pick my mouth up going, Jesus Christ. And so I think generally, the community in general is actually, you know, yes, the ARMv7 builders aren't particularly fast. Yes, we have a plan, and ARMv8, much, much faster hardware in process, so that we can start doing ARMv7 on ARMv8 to solve that problem. It's a little bit down the line. It involves a bunch of people, primarily me, and engaging with Vert people and a whole bunch of other stuff to do some work to polish that up and make it beautiful and usable. So, and in case of like power builders, like the Power 8 hardware actually makes our x86-64 hardware look slow and ancient. So there's stuff there that things like hardware concerns with regards to speed and quality and various other bits and pieces are very much in process to being addressed as part of that proposal.
The very specific feature question related to what you just said, and I want to ask it because I know the answer is somewhere in this room and I've had a hard time finding it. So when I get my 64-bit, my affordable 64-bit ARM stuff in December, right? 6 months. 6 months.
No, he's saying next month. But
next
he
month.
Also told me June.
Yes.
So
yes.
Whenever he says something, I always just go, yeah, John.
The other next month.
So
I get that.
To ensure,
he
says next month, I was saying to him that'll be 2018 then.
Right. So John's lies are always even more optimistic than yours.
Yeah.
But will I be able to...
John, do I not question your timelines and...
You tell more realistic lies than
more realistic. So I'll try and...
Achievement unlocked.
Let me get my question out. Will I be able to do hardware-accelerated V7 virtual machines on V8?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. We have that working now.
We do. I wouldn't know because I can't get the hardware.
So there
is one thing. But your machine needs to have 32-bit ARM support in CPU because this is optional.
So the caveat there, if you take the caveat example, it's public knowledge at this point, they did not implement 32-bit.
Okay.
Some of the people, when you buy hardware, you won't have V7 supported.
Okay. So they're army in that way.
But that cheap one that's coming out, the 1.3.4.6, that one definitely has the support.
Okay. Yeah, the one I'm thinking of, that's under $500, coming very soon. That's the one you...
The publicly announced 96-board Enterprise Edition.
Yes.
Right. Has the ability to do that.
I believe there may be a demo coming up at a major ARM event in the next couple of months.
So one of the internal guys spent a bunch of time going through all of this to make sure it happened.
Cool.
And he sent me this amazing email that I kid you not, if I printed it out, it would be about this long on how to make it work. To deploy it nicely into Fedora infrastructure and various other bits and pieces, there is no way in hell I am going to be running a QEMU command line this long.
We need to get libvirt.
So basically, I'm taking that recipe and I am polishing it and engaging with the libvirt guys and the QEMU guys, and we're going to get a, dare I say, this U-boot in place that we can boot U-boot, so we can do standard Anaconda installs with it, standard Yum upgrades with it, which with the process that we currently have, we can't do. But ultimately, that was a proof of concept to ensure we could do it and to engage with, like, there was a bug in BinUtils with regards to 64K versus 4K page sizes, which the fix actually landed, to give you an idea how long we've been doing this, landed fairly early in the F22 cycle. It needed a mass rebuild of everything to ensure that it worked. In the F22 cycle, after that landed, a minimal install build route had everything just through standard upgrades and package churn in the distro dev cycle we could run a minimal F22 install as such. And so, and because I knew we weren't going to have the hardware and the other bits in place beforehand, I wasn't going to yell and scream about a mass rebuild just for this in F22. We've now had the mass rebuild in F23, so everything's there is needed. I mean, this is a project that I've been inching towards over the last, over 12 months.
Cool.
So all the bits are slowly coming together to enable that, and yes, you will be able to do it.
And the cool thing is, once Peter gets that faster hardware, the other part of it is that there's going to be more and more. So once you get it working once,